Vanakkam,
Vanakkam.
how are you, Ryan? Thanks for joining.
Quite well. Quite well, Jasper. How about you?
Very good, very good. Thank you. For the lesson today, it would be nice if you can give us an outline of what we are going to see today, what the things that we're going to learn today.
Thank you, Jasper. It's good to be back here. So, today, coming from the last two sessions where we looked at sonnets of Shakespeare. We were going to look at a contemporary of Shakespeare who didn't write sonnets, but he wrote songs. So I was going to call this Sonnet to Song. And we talked a bit about him at the end of last week's session. And his name, of course, is John Dowland. So this week we're going to look closely at a song of John Dowland, the contemporary of Shakespeare. And see the way in which it differs from a sonnet, and of course, also hear how it's set to music at the same time. And Dowland, his poetry presents a metaphysics very similar to Shakespeare. And studying Dowland and listening to John Dowland helps a lot in understanding Shakespeare as well. So they really go together excellently. So that's why I thought it was worth it to do one session on Dowland, along with Shakespeare before we move on to a Shakespeare play next time. They come from the same world, as it were. The intellectual and spiritual world is identical or very similar in any case. So in that light, we can look at, first I'll just give a brief background of Dowland and talk a bit an important aspect of his philosophy. And then we can look closely at Unquiet Thoughts, which we ended last week's session with, a close reading of Unquiet Thoughts. And then if we have time, we'll look at one more Dowland song of a different kind. So as I said, John Dowland, he had almost the exact same lifetime as Shakespeare. Shakespeare was born in 1564, and John Dowland, I believe, was born in 1563. And Dowland died a few years after Shakespeare, so they were completely contemporaneous, probably even knew each other. Dowland was based in London, and he was became very famous as a lutenist. Now, some of our listeners might not know what a lute is. It's an ancient precursor to the guitar, which is one of the most popular instruments in modern times. It originally came from Arabia, where it was called oud. And what was popular in 16th century Europe was what was called a Renaissance lute, which is rather like a guitar, but it has eight strings, eight different notes instead of six like a guitar, and it has quite a different sound. And it's also never strummed; it's just plucked. In some of the recordings of Dowland, you will be able to hear lutes playing in the background, and of course, Dowland a lot of music for lute, for solo lute. That he's well known for amongst lutenists and guitarists. But where Dowland is interesting for us is that his poetry comes from a very similar world as Shakespeare's poetry. So the kind of music that's in a sonnet that we talked about last week, where it isn't really set to oral music, it has its own internal music. Dowland has more of a lyric, where the poetry is set to external music as well and becomes a song. So that's why I thought this was called from sonnet to song. Right. So as I said, Dowland lived at the same time as Shakespeare. He was apparently born in London, though some people say he was born in Dublin, Ireland. And he'd hoped to get a job as one of the lutenists for Queen Elizabeth, but he didn't get that job. So instead, he took a job in the court in Denmark. He was with the King of Denmark and was very popular with the Danish king. And that is where he wrote his famous books of songs from. Though he published them in London, he was actually living in Denmark. But his wife was in England, so he often was back to England visiting her. And as I said, he died around the same time as Shakespeare. So he'd no been known for his lute works, and suddenly, excuse me, in 1597, he published his first book of songs. Then in 1600, 3 years later, he published a second book of songs. And finally in 1603, 3 years later yet again, he published a third book of songs. So he published three books of songs, 3 years apart each. Each book of songs has exactly 21 songs, which is seven times three. And the number seven is also very important for John Dowland, as we'll talk about a little bit later. So this is part of the whole Renaissance numerology, which you can also find in Shakespeare, certain sacred numbers. You know, seven, of course, is the seven different notes of the octave before the repeat. Three is usually said to be the law of three. We find that in Christianity with the Father, the Son, and the Holy Ghost, the Trinity. So three and seven being very important numbers. All of this, like a typical Renaissance artist, they tried to include everything in their art. But whereas Shakespeare's dramas are quite huge and titanic, Dowland is almost a miniaturist. With him, there's incredible concision in his work. And that's why it repays very close listening and repeated listening. Each song of his and his other works is like a little gemstone, which you can look at very carefully and keep drawing all sorts of deep emotions out of. And in fact, after he finished publishing the three books of songs in 1604, 1 year after that, he published his final major work, which he called the Lachrimae. Lachrimae is Latin for tears. And there's a double meaning for that as well, which I'll explain presently. So I'm just leading up to the first song of the first book in 1597, which was Unquiet Thoughts. So that's the song and the poetry that inaugurates this whole wonderful cycle of three books and the Lachrimae that Dowland completed, with very clear, important numbers and harmonies going through it. One of the qualities of Dowland that's celebrated in his music is the quality of sorrow. Like one of his famous lute pieces before he published the songs was called Semper Dowland, Semper Dolens, which translates roughly from Latin as always Dowland, always sad. Now, the sadness and the sorrow that permeates his music is not necessarily what we might in the modern age call depression. It's more of a study of what sorrow is. And Dowland loved to elide in his music that at the depths of sorrow and at the deepest depths of sorrow, one also finds the most transcendent joy. So this unity of joy and sorrow is one of the great points that Dowland studies, which of course is also very prominent throughout the works of Shakespeare. So that's why going into this special take of Dowland on sorrow, it gives us a window into a lot of Shakespeare's poetry and drama as well. So this song cycle begins with Unquiet Thoughts and ends really with the Lachrimae. And the Lachrimae is basically a melody from one of the most famous songs he ever wrote, which is the second song from the second book called Flow My Tears. I'll sing it briefly to get the mood. So the song is this. Flow my tears, fall from your springs. Exiled forever, let me mourn. Where night's black bird the sad infamy sings, there let me live forlorn. Down vain lights shine you no more, no night is dark enough for those that in despair their lost fortunes deplore. Light doth but shame disclose. Never may my woe Those be relieved, since pity is fled, and tears and sighs and groans, my weary days have my joys divided. From the highest spire of contentment, my fortune is thrown, and fear and pain and grief for my deserts are my hope, since hope is gone. Hark, you shadows that in darkness dwell, learn to contemn light. Happy, happy they that in hell feel not the world's despite. That's the second book of the second song. It became a very famous song. And then that melody, la da 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 da, that melody became part of Dowland's final work called the Lachrimae. Okay? And Lachrimae, as I said, also is Latin for tears. And Dowland considered the Lachrimae, he said, this is my masterpiece. This is my final utterance as an artist. And this, of course, was published after the three book songs, using the melody from Flow My Tears. So, so just keep this in mind, and I'll just very quickly relate one of the simple essences of Dowland. As we said, sorrow is one of the great subjects he meditates on, and yet sorrow at its core turns into this transcendent healing joy. And joy at its very peak of ecstasy turns into a profound sorrow. This is the cycle between joy and sorrow he loves to study in his music. And Flow My Tears is particularly of an image that he liked to have, that that the goddess, the great Virgin Mary, Maria, she is above the earth, and her tears of compassion flow down to the earth below. And the musicians, hearing those tears, take those tears and turn them into the sweetest music. So the tears of the goddess, of the mother of God, and her compassion and love for all things is where this great compassionate voice comes out of Dowland's art. And then that's transfigured in a way into this high sorrow. So that movement between deep sorrow and deep joy is constant in Dowland's music. And the tears, he gets a double meaning in the lachrymae, because lachrymae, of course, is Latin for tears. And of course, the melody is from the song Flow My Tears, where tears also mean in the sense of levels, tears as in an ascent or a descent of levels, level one, level two, level three, tear, usually spelled T-I-E-R in English, as opposed to T-E-A-R, of the flowing tears of the goddess. So the seven tears of the lachrymae, which is the title of it, has this double meaning. It's both tears of sorrow, but it's also an ascent from the Flow My Tears melody up through six higher melodies until the final level of tears, which he calls true tears, lacrimae verae, true tears. And each level of the tears that the poet and the musician's soul ascends through is a purification of his mind and his being until he finally arrives at the seventh level, the heaven where the true tears are there. And I believe he start the first tier of the lachrymae. By the way, the lachrymae doesn't have any singing. It's completely instrumental. It's lute plus viols, right? So he did all this poetry of the songs, he put it aside, and he went, and his final work is this lachrymae, which is purely instrumental. And the first tier, which is called Old Tears, Lacrime Antique, that's the same exact melody as Flow My Tears, the song. But then it alters up to the seven tiers until finally there's the Lachrimae virae, the true tears. So that's an overview of Dowland's art, and I think we can listen for this, particularly if later you go more into his music. But we'll look at one of more deeply at the lyrics to his first song today, Unquiet Thoughts, that we talked about last week, and see perhaps how some of these themes are in there. And then keep in mind, as we move on to Shakespeare next time, how a lot of these exact Dowland themes run through Shakespeare as well. And it'll help us understand a lot of the poetry of the Shakespeare plays. So far, so good?
Yeah, it's good. It's good. One question, if I may ask. You
Please.
Were talking about Renaissance numerology, and you gave us this breakup of his work, the body of work, with 3 years gap in between and 21 songs. Are there any visible signs of this kind of numerology in Shakespeare's work also?
Yes. I mean, it's hard to say because Shakespeare is so vast. You can find almost anything in Shakespeare. Of course, Shakespeare avoids often the overtly mathematical, but you'll often have trinities and sevens and, you know, Shakespeare is always playing with everything. I'm trying to think of specific moments where Shakespeare speaks of music in this way, perhaps not so overt, because Shakespeare's coming out of the tradition of poetry, whereas the medieval musicians were all mathematicians. So music and number are very close related in medieval and early Renaissance thought. So it was quite common for the whole musical training that someone would have received in the Middle Ages was basically what we call mathematics in the modern sense. It's all the, you know, the music of the spheres and the relation of the planets and all these different musical harmonies, musical ratios, and what they meant to each other. Tuning, everything was very numerical. I'm trying to think where it's specifically thematic. You know, Shakespeare usually, I mean, yes, how we say in more hidden ways, absolutely, absolutely. Though I can't think of a specific example at the moment, but I'll share it if it comes up to me.
Thank you, Brian. We can go into the song now.
Okay. So with that in the background, let's look at Unquiet Thoughts, which is the inauguration of Dowland's song. And we sang it last week. And why don't we study it in the same way we'd study a sonnet and just meditate on what the lines might mean. If I can just do one last nip for the numbers, if you notice, and this is extremely common in Dowland, in Unquiet Thoughts, there's three different stanzas, right? There's three different mini poems that makes the whole thing. And that's most of Dowland's songs are like that. So these threes and sevens are all over the place in Dowland. 3 times 7, 21 songs in each collection. So yes, let's start with Unquiet Thoughts. So would you like to start? And then
yeah.
I'll carry on with you.
Sure. Unquiet thoughts, your civil slaughter stint, and wrap your wrongs within a pensive heart, and you my tongue that makes my mouth a mint, and stamps my thoughts to coin them words by art. Be still, for if you ever do the like, I'll cut the string that makes the hammer strike.
But what can stay my thoughts, they may not start, or put my tongue in durance for to die, when as these eyes, the keys of mouth and heart, open the locks where all my love doth lie. I'll seal them up within their lids forever, so thoughts and words and looks shall die together.
How shall I then gaze on my mistress' eyes? My thoughts must have some vent, else heart will break. My tongue would rust as in my mouth it lies, if eyes and thoughts were free, and not speak. Speak then, and tell the passion of desire, which turns mine eyes to floods, my thoughts to fire.
Thank you, Jasper.
Thank you. Thank you, Brian.
It's nice to just hear it spoken as a poem as well and not set to music. So yes, let's look at this first line. Unquiet thoughts, your civil slaughter stint. What's that line mean?
To me, it means the inner monologues that one has. It could come from worries, you know, when worrying about future, fear, or guilt.
Yes.
Things that don't let you rest. Thoughts that don't let you rest.
Interesting, yes.
And then I can also see the word slaughter, which directly talks about destroying something. So is it, what I don't understand is the word civil here, but more or less what I understand is this: these thoughts, these tormenting thoughts can make you, can kill you, can really be torturing, torturous. Right.
So this, yes, this perhaps a more common pronounced word is civil war. So civil slaughter is like an extreme civil war.
Okay.
Yeah. So to go back what you said at first, these unquiet thoughts, beautiful way to put, as you say, all these anxieties and things. It's as if thought should be quiet, whatever quiet means, but we have unquiet thoughts.
Yes.
Your civil war, your civil slaughter stint. And so stint, of course, means to stop.
Yeah.
So it's almost like the poet is starting this war that's going on in the soul between thoughts. Please stop. Your civil war, your civil slaughter stint. And and it makes me think of exactly like, you know, warring desires, right? You know, I'm married to one person, but I'm lusting after another person. Or I'm trying to have a quiet mind because I'm a monk, but my mind is buzzing all over the place. Or so this kind of civil war in the mind between contradictory desires, these unquiet thoughts. You know, it's this poem is starting off with stop this civil war. I think that's very good what you were saying. That's how I understand the civil slaughter stint. And then he continues, and wrap your wrongs within a pensive heart. So obviously these civil slaughter, they're wrap your wrongs. So and he uses this word wrap, which it gives an interesting image of the heart. Yeah, the penitent heart, the pensive. Yeah. And pensive often does mean as well, kind of, it's not aggressive, it's quite inward. You know, when we're pensive, it's sort of quiet. So wrap your wrongs. And like the heart embraces, it wraps these unquiet thoughts, which he says are wrongs. They have all these wrongs, which is perhaps what's igniting this civil slaughter, this conflict in the mind. So wrap your wrongs within a pensive heart. So that's the first strategy, right? It's the stop your slaughter and become pensive. And but I think you're right, Jasper, you said it also means reflective, doesn't it? Pensive.
Mm-hmm.
Perhaps linked to penitent, but it's a penitent reflection and mulling over, or a inward, you know, self-knowledge, looking into the civil war that's going on. Yes, wrap your wrongs within a pensive heart. And then another and you my tongue that makes my mouth a mint to stamp them thoughts, to coin them words by art. There's some nice thick Shakespearean poetry.
Yeah.
Does this line speak to you?
I'm not sure if I'm getting it, getting the meaning correct, but what it means to me when I hear this, when I see the lines in front of me, is mostly people say artists make their inner demons, make money out of their inner demons. Like they go to the darkness and then that's how they make art. So is that what it is? Because it says, and you, my tongue, that speaks, it is, make my mouth a mint. It's not very clear, but and stamps my thought to coin them words, to bring words through art. I don't know what I got is right, but that's what I understand.
That's interesting what you say. I had never thought of it in that way, Jasper. Quite interesting. You say artists sometimes are paid to go in and find their inner demons, then cast, you know, show them on the work of art and sell them through that, right? So in that, there are these wrongs. There is this civil slaughter. So in that sense, perhaps, yes, the poet is saying, it's rhyming with stint or stop. But of course, what he's describing here in a very elegant way is a process of making poetry, and like, and he's, and the metaphor he's using, of course, is a minting of coins.
Mm.
So, and you, my tongue, So now he's speaking first to the mind, then the heart, now the tongue. And you, my tongue, that makes my mouth a mint. So the tongue, which in which the whole logos and the language comes forth, it turns my mouth into a mint, with, of course, the obvious metaphor of minting of coins. And you, my tongue, that makes my mouth a mint, to stamp them thoughts, to coin them, okay, so to stamp, so the thoughts come to the tongue, and the tongue stamps them, to stamp them thoughts, to coin them words by art. So the words are coming out of these unquiet thoughts, right? And maybe that's linked to what you were talking about, that artists making money off their inner demons, possibly is one way this happens. But these coins that the tongue and the mouth is minting are being to stamp them thoughts, to coin them, to bring them into reality, word by art itself. So the act of the artist or art is the making these unquiet thoughts into coins or into living words that people speak between each other, right? So I find it a very beautiful metaphor for the whole creation of poetry. Of course, he gives it a slightly mechanical metaphor of the coin and minting press of money.
Yes,
but money has value, of course. So and you, my tongue, that makes my mouth a mint, to stamp them thoughts, to coin them words by art. So now he's addressing the tongue, and that moves us on to the third line, be still. So he's, what is this tongue? He's telling the tongue to be still, right? And you, my tongue.
Yeah.
And then he describes what the tongue is, which makes my mouth a mint. Tongue, be still. For if you ever do the like, I'll cut the strings that makes the hammer strike.
What sounds like a warning. Is that a warning there?
I suppose a warning, or well, it's interesting. So be still, and if you ever do the like, I guess the like of being still, right? It's quite interesting. He says if you do, he doesn't say if you do it, you know. Be still, and if you ever do the like, if you ever do something, what's a likeness? A likeness is approaching something, but it's not the same, right?
Yeah.
So why that particular qualification? You know, be still, and if you ever do the like, I assume, my understanding, the like of being still, or something like being still, I'll cut the string that makes the hammer strike.
Okay, then it's not a warning. Then it is the next step, perhaps.
It's the next step, yes, exactly. A process he's laying out. Almost, is it a reward? Cutting the string doesn't exactly...
Yeah. Well,
what's the metaphor? The hammer strikes, if you ever seen an old minting of coins, there's a mold like gold, and you put the pattern of the coin and the hammer strikes it and imprints it like that, yes?
Yes.
So the string that makes the hammer and brings out the words, if you ever are still, I'll cut the string that makes the hammer strike. The string is the power that gives the hammer this minting power. So in this case, it's the power of thought that gives the tongue or the logos the ability to stamp words, which we speak with. Yes.
Okay. So is the poet saying that there won't be words anymore, and it will stop? There will be quiet. So the words also will cease. Is that what he's saying?
Yes, or perhaps. I mean, I can't totally grasp the metaphor, or it could be exactly what you're saying. Or he's even saying this is a strategy to try to stop the unquiet thought, so that maybe the string also will stop the thought-making mechanism.
Makes sense.
But I think you're right, Jasper, because I forget, if we looked forward to the next line, the next stanza number two, then he says, but what can stay my thoughts? So I think you're right that this will stop the minting process of the speaking of the words. But this doesn't totally solve the problem, right? The unquiet thoughts with their civil war, they've been wrapped in the pensive heart, and perhaps the string that makes the hammer strike, which the word has created, is cut. So let's move on to the next one, which starts with, but what can stay my thoughts? They may not start. So from the previous line, he describes the mechanism of how the thoughts become the tongue, the word, and mints these words. And if the tongue is still, we can solve that problem. But what can stay, what can stop my thoughts? They may not start. Still, the unquiet thoughts are quietly
having
without speech in there. Fire, you know, contending with each other in this civil slaughter. But what can stay my thoughts? They may not start. They seem to start by themselves. Or put my tongue endurance for to die. Put my tongue endurance. Endurance, of course, the modern pronounce we have endurance, but endurance means to also to duration. It means to put in like almost a cell, or what can stop them, or imprison.
Imprison them.
Or put my tongue endurance for to die. So clear on these two lines?
Yes.
But
yes.
What can stay my thoughts? They may not start. Or put my tongue endurance for to die. And then it continues, when as these eyes, the keys of mouth and heart, open the locks where all my love doth lie. There's a line well worth meditating on.
As these eyes, the keys of mouth and heart. When I was reading, I found I was not able to make much sense of these lines. The first two lines were pretty much, I was able to understand it because this is universal. We are all trying to quiet our thoughts. Everybody is apprehensive about things and they all
yes.
are seeking this. And that's why people go to meditate or maybe go on a holiday or things like that. So,
yes.
And the next one,
yes.
When as these eyes, the keys of mouth and heart, open the lock where all my love doth lie. I did not understand these two lines, so I do not know how to see them.
Right. Okay. Well, this is something that's studied a lot by Shakespeare. You know, obviously the eyes through the vision of the beloved, the vision of beauty, it comes in through the eyes, right? So he's, so what can stay my thoughts? They may not start, or put my tongue endurance for to die when these eyes, the keys, so the keys, what, you know, which opens both mouth and heart, when I see beauty, when I see my beloved, open the locks where all my love doth lie. So, I mean, a lot of things there. So the eyes open this whole disturbing, you know, in your, as you were often saying, quoting Leonard Cohen, there's no cure for love. So these eyes are causing lots of problems in that they're going around falling in love and they're opening the locks where my love doth lie. So I am seeing this as a hint that love is the cause of these unquiet thoughts, right? That deep down at the root of it, it's love that is, you know, the trouble. right now, the perhaps love would lie, as he put it, there, but it's behind locked doors. It lies there quietly, but these eyes look around and are awakened by seeing the beloved, and they open the locks, and all the troubled love wakes up, and we've got the source of the trouble. Does that sound reasonable?
Very much, very much. We were just, we had a recent experience last couple of weeks like this. Like we were out on a walk and we were coming back home, and my wife saw a bunch of puppies, and one was very weak, and she said, let's nurse the puppy. And I told her, like, let's get back home, we don't have time. But she said, oh, I love her, very sweet, very cute, very small. Then we got the puppy home, and 2 weeks were kind of, everything changed, you know, and the puppy died this morning. And we couldn't save the puppy, but several trips to the vet and, you know, everything changed. Like my work suffers, the house gets dirty, and all of that happens, and just because it is love, and we do it out of love, and I understand what...
That's so wonderful you did that, what that must have meant to the puppy, to have someone drop all their troubles of their life and just try to help him survive and thrive. You know, a beautiful thing you did. But I know now your house is dirty.
And several deadlines missed.
Several deadlines missed. Well, a dirty house and missing deadlines, maybe that's the sign of somebody who's living in love. So I can't but salute you. You're responding to love with these eyes. Yeah. Thank you. Interesting anecdote for the meaning of this. I'll just say it once again. When as these eyes, the keys of mouth and heart, open the locks where all my love doth lie. So then he goes on to decide, I'll seal them up within their lids forever. So words and thoughts and looks shall die together.
Yeah.
Here's his next strategy to tame these unquiet thoughts, right?
Yes.
It's a very beautiful line to me, because in a way you can see the whole tradition of the ascetic person, the monk, or the Buddha, trying to quiet their mind by cutting off the senses. So if I don't see the world and I close my eyes and I close my ears, then the mind can be still, and then in that stillness, perhaps God and happiness will come.
Yeah.
But here, with the fire of love burning beneath, it's not letting him do that, right? Its eyes are open. So now, maybe if I just, I'll seal them up within their lids forever.
Yeah.
So thoughts and words and looks, the whole visual realm shall die together.
Yeah. Yeah. Makes sense. And it's beautiful.
Beautiful, yes. Yeah, but like when you add the music, it really brings the emotion of that out, doesn't it, as well?
And also,
can I move on to the third?
If you can talk to us about the act of writing, the love this person has for the craft, and he thinks of music, thinks of words, thinks of rules, mathematical rules. He gives up his time to construct these things that are so deep within us and universal, even after so many. I mean, it's going to be forever. It's been like this forever. That is fascinating. And it is nice to actually meditate upon that fact, this craftsman sitting there and doing his work, bearing the weight of the world on his shoulders.
Absolutely. And of course, this was the great Renaissance task, that all the arts, from cleaning the house to making cutlery or furniture or clothes, everything was, there was an attempt to make it all reflect, the glory and beauty of existence. The ideal expressed, for example, in Florence, Firenze, Renaissance Florence, the Serenissima Repubblica, the Republic of Serenity, where beauty would shine out through all the arts in every direction. So every person in their work, in their house, in their painting, in their look, they would try to beautify and ennoble every aspect of life. And this is the English Renaissance, where these same principles really had this nice flowering around 1600 with Dowland and Shakespeare. Shakespeare purely in terms of poetry, and Dowland in this wonderful world of music and song, which is music and poetry together, coming together. But absolutely, the words by art. So art as this essential work and worship of life. Mm-hmm. And in that sense, discriminating between the kind of weaker art, just whatever sudden, like some random self-expression, and this kind of art that has tremendous meditation and knowledge and sacrifice behind it, which we might be called the universal art. And then these things, these kind of artistic works like Leonardo da Vinci's, they last many, many ages because they communicate something universal. They're not merely fashionable or momentarily trendy. So someone like the music of Dowland, for example, like a popular modern musician who loves Dowland, and you may hear a lot of his songs, is Sting. If you've ever, you're an artist called Sting, a British He was in a popular band in the 80s called The Police.
Yes.
So songs like Every Breath You Take. So lurking behind these songs are King of Pain. There's a song about sorrow. And so he became very fascinated by his, you know, countryman Dowland's songcraft and wrote this into a lot of his songs. I think he even released a recording not too long ago where he was solo singing some of Dowland's songs. So Dowland is this great well of inspiration for the English songsmiths of later times. But what is this quality where one can create poetry and music and art that's so sublimely finished and careful, and you don't let you know, when, like, people were pressuring Miyazaki to come out with his next movie, and he just turned to me and goes, I won't make crap. Like, he goes, I could make something now, but it would be crap. And I refuse to, but I'd rather do nothing than present crap.
Yeah.
So there's a kind of fierceness towards only doing your best, only actually, you know, completing a work of art when it truly is worthy of that universal appellation art. Yeah. That definitely was a great ambition of these English Renaissance artists, you know, Shakespeare, Dowland, and many others. A lot of artist sacrifice. Yes, and this is, of course, the theme of our song as well. So he's tried the option of sealing his eyes, his lids forever, so love can stay lying and not trouble. And then but then of course, the third stanza, as we said, this number three comes up a lot in Dowland. That's not going to work either, is it? The first line is, how shall I then gaze on my mistress' eyes? If I do that, if I seal my eyes, how can I gaze on my mistress' eyes? Because my love has flown out of me into the mistress.
Yeah.
So it's no longer I just hold it in myself. It's flown out into the beautiful beloved. And it's in her eyes. It lives in her eyes. But how shall I gaze upon my mistress' eyes? My thoughts must have some vent. A vent meaning else heart will break.
Yes.
Right? So there's no option here to seal it up.
Yes.
And live in peace, because the mistress has pulled the soul out of you.
Yes.
How shall I then gaze on my mistress' eyes? My thoughts must have some vent, else heart will break, then I'll die.
Yes.
My tongue would rust as in my mouth it lies. Very beautiful double metaphor there. You know, rusting, of course, is something getting old through lack of use.
Yes.
And so my tongue, because I've, you know, cut the strings and I've closed my eyes, it's just lying there in my tongue. But Shakespeare and the British love to make the double meaning of this word lie, meaning both lying down, but also to tell a falsehood. So the implication is that the tongue lies in my mouth, rusting. I'm false to the function of the tongue.
Yes.
Which then implies on the inverse that the whole point of the tongue is to praise the beloved. It's that is the height of all art, is the praising of the beloved, this thing that I see in my mistress' eyes. My thoughts must help, they have to have vent from seeing that vision, else heart will break. My tongue would rust as in my mouth it lies, if eyes were free to see but dare not speak. So now a transition back to the eyes opening. So he has to, like, when we would sing this song in my group, we'd get into the passion of the second verse and we'd close our eyes. And so thoughts and words and looks shall die together. We become like monks, closing our eyes and closing our senses. And then we'd say, how shall I then? And we'd say, gaze, and our eyes would spring open. And that was always incredibly effective with any audience that we sang it to, that all our eyes would open as once, that we're back into this gazing upon the beloved. How shall I then gaze? It's a beautiful line. How shall I then gaze along this long gaze? You feel like opening your eyes when that verse comes up. That's the genius of the music. How shall I then gaze upon my mistress' eyes? My thoughts must have some vent, else heart will break. My tongue would rust as in my mouth it lies, if eyes were free to see and dare not speak. Why dare not speak? Dare not speak. What's daring linked to?
Taking, well, I think he is trying to find a way all along, and I think he's arrived at some kind of an agreement that whether I see, but I will not talk about it, I will not take a chance, because when I speak, it becomes, I don't know, he's tormented again. Maybe it's just, he thinks if he
like
does.
Like you said, yeah, I'll not take a chance.
I'll not
like,
take a
so
chance.
Daring.
Yeah.
So eyes are free to see, but are dare not speak. So they're afraid.
Yeah.
So daring, there's a courage quality that suddenly is called upon, right?
Yeah.
Eyes are free to see, but dare not speak. Like if we go into the personal experience thing, I don't know about you, but certainly when I first started gazing at beautiful mistresses, I suppose in my teens, I would just try to hide it because I didn't, I of course, it naturally my tongue wanted to say something, but I was so shy about what nonsense might come out of my tongue that I would kind of clamp my mouth shut. So I didn't have the daring to speak what I felt when I fell in love with them. Because that, like, you know, as you were saying with the puppy, this could cause all kinds of disasters. I'll march out and I'll say, I'm in love with you, Karen. And like, everyone will laugh at me, all my friends, right? So,
so
there's this stage of love where the heart is bursting, but you dare not speak.
Yes.
But the rhythm of the music and the song, of course, comes out with this, the final refrain again, speak then. So speak is, you know.
Yeah.
And so now we're back to speak then, where we stopped speaking in the first stanza, but now speak then and tell the passions of desire, which turn my, that beautiful line, turn my eyes to floods. Of course, floods, flooding eyes and lachrimae and tears. This is very Dowland-esque. Turn my eyes to floods and my thoughts to fire. So it's as if this path of love, it rises up from the heart through the gaze of beauty, and then it turns the thoughts to fire. And is the thoughts turning to fire, is that the solution to the unquiet thoughts? Are fiery thoughts, blazing thoughts, they're definitely unquiet, but
there is a redeeming quality.
Flooding,
there is a redeeming quality.
Sorry?
There is a redeeming quality.
Redeeming quality, yes.
Yeah.
Because now the tears have sprung, you see.
Yeah.
Somehow, remember, the lachrimae moves to the true tears. So the tears have flooded, and now the thoughts can become fire, as they should be when they gaze upon the beauty of the mistress.
Yes.
And I think it's very beautiful that this, you know, the solution to this whole problem is to tell the passions of desire. So, which needs a certain daring honesty to do. Because, like, you know, these passions of desire are not smooth. They're mad. This mad thing wells up in my heart when I see the mistress. But I now will have the daring to speak them.
Wow.
Passions of desire. And I think that's why this is the introductory song to Dowland's 63 songs, because the next 62 songs will tell, are all about the passions of desire.
Oh, okay.
So 62 songs flowing along, like Shakespeare's 154 sonnets telling the passions of desire.
Okay.
So I think it's very artful, purposefully, this song is the first song. It's the inaugural
song,
that has given birth to all this composition.
Wow.
It's telling these passions of desire.
He has built this entire thing like how someone builds a house, like laying a foundation, planning.
Yeah, like building a house, absolutely. Or in this case, more like a cathedral or a temple or something.
He's
built some great beauty that is every stone is in perfect place with every other one. Great, great care has been put into this.
And is there a technique or anything that, is there a name for this technique? Were there other poets and songwriters doing this? Because when you were singing, and what caught my attention was the word gaze, And it very nicely synchronizes itself with just when you like closed eyes and the word gaze, it like kind of opens. The word itself is like something opening.
Yes.
And also when it's set to music, the word is elongated, it's stretched. And it's like a long gaze, like you said. And
yes.
So these are, I find them as like writing techniques and also music making techniques. Is there a name for it? Were there other people doing this? Can you talk about it a little?
The name, of course, for Dowland is art. You know, they take this one word, art, like Shakespeare with the word wit, and they give it tremendous learning and understanding is behind that word. But obviously, you know, they have the powers that people like Shakespeare and Dowland had came from the culture at their time. You know, that may not be possible in our time, Jasper. Maybe something else is possible. But obviously in the culture we live in, there's not like a common effort to create great art. What we have is self-expression, that kind of whatever's in your mind, just pour it out. And love isn't necessarily taken as some kind of great or high thing, right? Perhaps I would interpret it because we're not up to the demands that it's placing upon us. So a lot of this modern thinking, like some of these people say Dowland is a minor poet, they're, you know, to quote, you know, the poet Shelley, you know, these people, you know, their sails of their boat were never to the tempest given. So, you know, to be on a boat to the bark of life and to give your sails to the tempest, you know, is terribly dangerous, right? So perhaps this very quality of courage is one of the things that's not really there so much in the modern world. And maybe that's why people are so attracted to athletics, because in athletics, they get something of that courage.
Or is it because knowledge is so scattered and divided, fragmented?
Yes, I think that, of course, that too. There's so much, and there necessarily everything becomes understood in a kind of everything is equal sort of way. Maybe necessarily, you know, just because, I mean, maybe that's one of the wonderful possibilities of our time, is so much is available. Whereas obviously, though, of course, Dowland and Shakespeare were coming out of a very inward-turned world of the medieval, a monastic world, changing into a political world or an outward world where art became the unifying force between the inward goodness and outward harmony. So the art, I mean, that's, of course, I should perhaps reemphasize that point, that for all the Renaissance artists, Italy, everywhere, it wasn't just expression. They had a duty to bring the most sublime utterances out, because that could bring the inward to the outward. That's what will redeem the world. That's what will make the kingdom of heaven on earth. So the go forth and spread the word, that's it. The word is this great art. It's not the word of, you know, just simply follow this person or follow that person. It actually needs to transfigure the whole earth into heaven. That is the Renaissance ideal. Which in Dowland's case is the kind of ascent of the mind through these seven tiers of perception, or seven tiers of artistic understanding, until one can finally compose true tears. This of course is your public duty as an artist, to make the world beautiful and harmonious and all the other things, but you can only do that through great art. It's not really the will to have great art, you need the knowledge too. So people like Shakespeare and Dowland obviously studied and read a great deal, and the whole culture around them reflected a kind of art, which ours and all of its kind of, you know, global mishmash of everything, it's difficult to do. So, you know, it's understandable in our time, you don't want to be too judgmental. So just let everybody sort of have their own way, so we can kind of all get along as a globe. But I think the call of great art is still there, and its purpose as well. And perhaps that's why, you know, Dowland and Shakespeare in this Renaissance time has such a rich, destined call to us. That's what I felt in my life. We've got endless art. Every person can turn on YouTube and make some video of anything and put it out there. So we've got instant global communication, but what's being communicated isn't necessarily worth communicating, right? So now the question arises, what should human beings say to one another? What should human beings do? What makes life heavenly, as opposed to hellish. Shakespeare and Dowland's words.
Like unquiet thoughts versus thoughts on fire.
Yes, the civil slaughter of unquiet thoughts could be said to be, we could call that bad art. And it results in a world constantly in strife. So at least in this song, he's decided that something rises up through this path of love, where I can, what if I can, with my eyes in floods and my thoughts to fire, I can speak the passions of desire. And that will redeem something about this, these unquiet thoughts of my mind. And it's been our theme since the beginning of these talks, this demand that love makes upon us. It's not easy. It's not something that we can just ignore. It burns like a flame underneath us, and forces us to evolve, or forces us to learn, or however we want to put it. That's how I'm seeing it anyway, Jasper. I don't know about you.
And you also, as a language teacher and teacher of drama, and you're interested in Shakespeare, and also you went out. You taught in Japan, you went to Japan, you stayed there, you lived and taught there, you taught in India. Do you find artist or art, even writing, poetry and songs, coming out in regional languages, in the, like Japanese songs, which is set to something deeper from that culture?
Absolutely. I mean, of course, there's many different arts. There's, you know, the Japanese, rather like Indians, they turn every aspect of life, and I suppose like the European Renaissance, every aspect of life was an art. So whatever you're good at, you perfect yourself through that. You know, for example, there's a story of, if I can just throw a little anecdote from the Japanese world in. One of the most famous warriors and samurais of Japan lived around the time of Shakespeare, 1600s, Miyamoto Musashi, and he wrote a book of the Five Rings, which became later the guide for samurais, and not only teaching on how to be a great warrior, but how to live a good life and balanced life, this sort of warrior, virtuous warrior philosophy. And there's a novel that talks about his life, and there's a wonderful scene in it where what these Japanese samurais did around that time was it was perfecting their sword art. And they had a way where the whole of the world didn't matter. All that mattered was the extreme perfection of the art. And a lot of people find that austerity in Japan today. Little arts like making tea are taken to extreme levels of devotion and care. Just to make one perfect bowl of tea completes your whole life. So that's a very similar principle we're talking about. But anyway, with this Miyamoto Musashi, he hears there's a swordsman. He's defeating everybody. Nobody can defeat him. So but he knows he's not a perfect swordsman. There's something wrong with his art. So he hears that up in one part of Japan, there's an aged lord named Yagyu Sekishusai. And he goes up there to challenge him to see if truly, and often the samurai challenge where two warriors fight to the death determines who has the superior art. And the first principle of the warrior is you do not fear death. So they don't mind dying. Their whole mind is totally focused on just the perfection of their art. So dying is no problem, but not achieving great art is a big problem. So he goes up into the mountains, and Sekishusai is a rich local lord, and he doesn't meet him. He won't see him, but he puts Musashi up in a room, and Musashi stays there for months. And Sekishusai refuses to see him. He keeps asking, can I see Sekishusai? I want to challenge him. And they say, no, you're not allowed to see him. And he's sitting in this room for months, little room, and he's getting bored, just sitting there like a samurai. And after a long time, he starts gazing at all of his surroundings. And at one point, one thing he notices every day, it's a very Spartan, sparse room, but someone brings in one vase with a single flower in it every day, a little glass vase. And suddenly one day he's looking at the vase, and he notices the way the flower that's in the vase is cut, that there's a particular cut. Whoever cut the flower to put it in the vase, it has a certain quality. And just one glance at that, he understands that it was Yagyu Sekishusai who cut the flower. And in just that tiny cut, the master, like Musashi, can see that there's a tremendous genius, that were he to fight Sekishusai, he would die. because there's no way somebody like that kind of capacity to use a sword and to cut in that way is something that Musashi has absolutely no understanding of. And so he gets up, leaves the room, and walks away. And never meets Yagyu Sekishusai. But just the old man was sending this message, you know, here's how I cut. Can you match me? And in a way, was giving him a mercy, because otherwise his life would have ended there with this genius for cutting. So even this thing about the knife and how the knife cuts, and that comes up to this day, perhaps in sushi cutting or something. But just to how you use a knife to slice something can have an incredible depth and beauty of action. So that's an example, maybe coming from Japan. But I think all cultures have these kind of, this kind of art that is, that is properly called great, where people, put all lesser desires aside to just achieve some tremendous thing in their art. I think that's a universal human quality. And what Dowland is doing, I think, is he's trying to describe how this is linked to love and the pressure that love exerts upon our life and our souls and drives us to this perfection so that we can say something worthy of the beloved. So, that's, my tongue lies in my mouth because I'm afraid. I dare not speak because I'm going to say something so stupid. I want to match the beauty I'm seeing, but my tongue doesn't have the right words for it, right? So there's a pressure to become an artist and speak words that are worthy of what my gaze takes in.
That's so beautiful. I mean, it's a. I mean, we. I hope we have the time and to do one full Dowland series to see all the 63 songs. I don't know. Maybe another. I don't
Yeah.
know. We can
Probably
start.
should do that later because this is a Shakespeare path we're going on. So, but I wanted to at least open up people to Dowland as someone one can listen to and meditate on and sing or play if you play a guitar or a lute. That gives wonderful insight into Shakespeare and this Renaissance world and a lot of great treasures of Western European history.
That was a wonderful chat. That was a wonderful lesson today. I mean, what we learned today about writing with some techniques, paying attention to words, crafting your work in line with certain rules, and bringing out some universal truths. And also the poem itself is very beautiful, the inner monologue of how to make this strife, this tormenting, this anxiety into legitimate anxiety, just random mad
Yes.
anxiety to legitimate anxiety. And that's nice. That's very beautiful.
Yes. That in trying to get rid of anxiety in a way, we're perhaps getting root of the very force that's driving us towards making a beautiful life, right? The anxiety, the unquiet thoughts, which is a more rather more pretty way rather than this metaphysical term anxiety. It should, great art will show this is, don't worry about it. This is exactly to bring you to, crafting your life very beautifully. That that's what I think, great art should always show us this.
Now, I see a
I see a
lot
lot of.
of craftsmen on YouTube building things. There's one channel, I think I will link that channel. It's called Drew Builds Stuff. I think it's Drew Builds Stuff. I'm not sure. I'll have to recheck. So this young man who's building wonderful things, and he's very, it's like meditative. He's very focused, and he goes back and he's very meticulous about his work and measuring everything. And he builds wonderful things like campers that you can take along with your bicycle or motorcycle. Wonderful things. So maybe you should, and when you were talking about, people not worried about anything else but just that work, they don't want to put out anything substandard. They want to really
Yes,
leave no stones
that's it. We can see
unturned.
it all over YouTube, can't we, in different things. Like if you look, for example, one of the companions to a musician like Dowland is, of course, the lute makers. And you can find on YouTube, there's people to this day that are hugely passionate about making musical instruments. And indeed, there's people who make lutes still, Renaissance lutes. And the their passion and art and that they put into it is tremendous. So this is universal in the sense of the whole of life. Has this pull towards art. This is the European Renaissance view of art, actually. And it's perhaps to this day why Europe is rather a beautiful place. The beautiful building of the environment is a very important feature of human existence. So I think that will hopefully also give us a little boost as well when we start looking at a Shakespeare play next time.
Absolutely.
We've got like a good background now with another Renaissance artist very close to Shakespeare.
Yes.
So we can start moving into the plays, and it'll help us understand many of the themes much better.
Yes. So we are going to do in the next session, we're going to see sonnet. Are we going to see a sonnet or a play?
I thought you and I could start studying a play together. I was thinking A Midsummer Night's Dream, Shakespeare's most popular play. So since we're kind of doing a sort of beginner's course, that's a really good one to start with.
Yes.
And has many of the themes we've talked about, absolutely.